desire to honor you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, with all of my heart, I worship you.
Thank you, Holy Ghost. Well, welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome to Therapure. We're just almost about to begin, so I want to invite you, as you're tuning on, please do me the favor of going ahead and sharing or starting a watch party so that we can be able to kick off together and to trust God to speak to us expressly as we began the new month and as we've also begun the new week. God's word will come expressly, something profound will happen to you, and I trust that you will be blessed tremendously. Please, again, as you are tuning in, do me a favor by just going ahead and sharing and also starting a watch party so that we could have other people coming in. Don't forget to also get to let me know where exactly you're watching from. Participate also through your comments. It will also be a blessing to also get to have your comments come into place. So let's keep on coming in, let's keep on coming on board, let's come online as much as we can. And as we're doing that, please again, tag a friend, share, start a watch party. And then also as you're preparing that we should get into the word, go with me to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 10. As we're just about to start in the next 60 seconds, we are going to be kicking off and starting a very powerful word over this week. God is going to speak to us. God is going to minister to us by his grace and his mercy in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to God in the highest. 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 Amen and amen and amen. Praise God and happy new week to each one of you. Happy new month to those of you that may have just joined. And probably we actually just got to meet over last week. I want to welcome you once again to Therapure. And I trust that even as we're kicking off this program this week, that God is going to speak to you and that you're going to be blessed even as we continue. Pastor Tony, it's a blessing to see you. Always a blessing. I know watu wa Kirinyaga wako. Wako ready. Amen. Praise God. So let's keep on coming online. Let's keep on coming online. As you do so, please take the liberty to share. Also go ahead and start a watch party if you need to. Tag a friend. And let's see how we could be able to build what the Lord is actually calling us to over this new week. Sophie, you're so much welcome. It's a blessing to also have you now. I just want us to go straight into the word and then we're going to pray and then deal with what the Lord has been laying in my spirit as we kick off this week. So let's start by praying first of all and then we go into the word. And so Father, we want to appreciate you that you have given us an opportunity such as this one to get into your word. I pray that today, Lord, even as we are starting off this program, I want to believe you that God, you're going to speak to somebody who is tuning in right now, somebody who is watching and somebody who God will even watch probably later. I want to believe you that God, no life will remain the same in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, but that there would be a shift in the lives of many. We are committing this entire week to you and this entire month into your hands. And we believe you to set a pathway, a highway on the behalf of your people, that people will be on cruise mode and enjoy uncommon flows of that which God you have intended for them. So we declare that the entire week is redeemed. We declare that this session that we are having is redeemed. We declare that the counsel of God is made available. And we thank you for the spirit of revelation and wisdom in Jesus' precious and a holy name. And we all shouted a good amen and amen and amen. Pastor Anita, good to see you. You're all welcome. Please, again, as you're coming in, participate also with your comments as we are building up. And I trust the Lord will bless us in Jesus' name. So let's go straight into the word. I'm in 1 Peter chapter number 5 and verses number 10. 1 Peter 5 and verse 10. Now, each one of you that is good in Bible study will get to realize that there are particular letters or epistles that were written to what we knew as the scattered tribes of Israel or the scattered Jews who are actually Messianic Jews during the time of the persecution. So if you read letters like 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, letters like James, letters like the book of Hebrews, letters like the book of 1 and 2 Peter, these were letters, and also the letter of Jude, these were letters that were actually written to what we consider as a scattered Messianic Jews, a scattered Messianic Jews who were born again believers, born again Jews who happened to be scattered by reason of the persecutions that were actually manifesting in the nation, manifesting in the land of Jerusalem or in the city of Jerusalem. And so it made them go ahead and scatter into different places. So these letters were actually assigned to go and encourage them to build up their faith and make them also be able to stand and not to forget and go back to Judaism, but rather to maintain their conviction and faith in terms of their salvation in the knowledge of what Christ Jesus had done for them. So when Peter is actually writing to them, Peter is writing to a group of people who had actually needed a lot of encouragement and had gone through great persecution. And so he's actually indicating certain factors to them to try and help or enable their faith to be jacked up once again. So I'm in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 10. The Bible says, "But the God of all grace, who had called us unto his eternal glory by Jesus Christ, after you have suffered a while," you know, that statement is a very hard one. He says, "After you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish you, strengthen and settle you." Now, this particular scripture produces or it generates 3 points that are very critical for us to focus on. The first one is the idea of process. The second one is the idea of grace. And the third one is what we consider as the idea of settlement. Now, the idea of what we call process here is revealed due to the fact that the Bible says, after you have suffered a while. Every person in life goes through process, whether saved one or not saved. We will always face process in one way or the other. Process is what basically determines the product or the outcome of an individual. Processes are not kind, neither good, but processes are necessary in life. We all go through it, even in salvation. Whenever we actually make progress in life, process is a part of what we actually are supposed to face. Now, I want to say that by the time this year began, in the month of January, February, and the month of March and April, the Holy Spirit had been putting within my heart that these first 4 months had been months where God had actually been allowing people to still undergo some level of processing so that he can be able to bring them into positioning of what exactly he wants to do. From this month of May, I have a very strong sensation that we are entering a season of a tremendous move of God. We are about to witness many things that will automatically begin to open and shift in our own personal life. Just here in Kenya, on the 1st of May, we have the president stand up and lift up what we consider as a ban that he had set up in terms of the lockdown in various towns and cities. And so he just ended up opening his mouth during Labor Day, and he said that now the what we consider as a lockdown has been lifted up, and even the time of curfew had ended up being extended, which was actually not just a natural statement. We must also take it as a prophetic utterance in the spirit. I want you to understand that from this month of May, many things will begin to shift in people's lives, in people's destinies. If you are sensitive enough in the spirit to get to discern this, you will get to notice that God is in the process of doing quite a lot. Just last week, I was teaching on restoration, and while I was speaking on it, it was a word God had given me heavily towards the end of April, and all of this again was just to position us for the things that God wants to do. Now, the word that God gave me in this month of May is a rest all around. Rest all around, or rest all around, depending on how you actually want to pick it up. But the word is that God is actually bringing people into a season of settlement, a season of rest. So that's why I'm saying that when I'm picking up the scripture in 1 Peter chapter number 5, there are three things that you actually look at. Number one is the aspect of process, which many of you that are tuning in have been possibly able to go through. January, there's something you may have actually gone through. The month of February, the month of March, and the month of April. And many people who have actually been facing quite a lot of uncertainties, you know, a lot of expectations that you are having, a lot of faith that you have been building, and processes that you've been actually going through. All of these have been gearing towards a certain end, and that's why God has brought us up until this month of May. So the first thing that 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 10 indicates to us is an aspect of process. The second thing is an aspect of grace. Now, in Peter's statements, Peter says here that the God of all grace is able, the God of all grace. So he mentions that after you have suffered a while, he says the God of all grace. So he speaks about God who is able to bring grace into our lives. That's what grace, I want you to notice, that what grace simply means, to bring people into a season of ease. Okay, I'm just giving a new terminology, new interpretation of it. A grace is simply a merited favor. It has diverse interpretations, but one of the core reasons for grace is to bring people into seasons of ease. Romans chapter 11 and verses number 6, Romans 11 and verse number 6, the Bible says, if it be of works, it is not of grace. And if it be of grace, then it is not of works. So whenever we deal with grace, we are dealing with an ease, a moment of ease, a season of ease, a time when the burdens are lifted off and people begin to notice that things are beginning to fall into place without any strain or any struggle whatsoever. So whenever grace comes into play, things begin to come to ease. So the Bible here speaking, Peter speaking here, he says, but the God of all grace, after you have suffered a while, look at that, the God of all grace, after you have suffered a while. So we notice process, and then we notice grace being brought into play. And then now ultimately we notice the aspect of settlement. So Peter here mentions four things. He says, the God of all grace, number one, what will he do? Perfect you. Number two, what will he do? Establish you. Number three, what will he do? Strengthen you. And number four, what will he do? He will settle you. Now these four words are all similar. It's only that he tries to bring them out in diversity. So he's talking about perfection, he's talking about establishment, he's talking about strengthening, and then ultimately he comes to the level of talking to us about settlement. That word settlement is equal to the word rest. Whenever you look at the word settlement, it means that somebody has been brought into a place of rest in their own personal life. Now, let me mention that God's will and desire is that he would want all his people to enter into a place of settlement. That's the purpose and the mind of God. God wants us to enter into a place of settlement. In Matthew chapter number 11 and verse number 28, the famous scripture people like using for evangelism, Matthew 11 and verse 28, Jesus says, come ye, all ye that labor, and I will give you rest. So notice that Jesus' intent is that people should be able to enjoy rest. Now, there are three aspects of rest whenever we are dealing with the connection of it in terms of God's perspective. Number one is that rest is God's promise. Rest is a promise from God. It is God's promise. God has already promised us rest. If you look at this in the book of Hebrews chapter number 4 and verses number 1, Hebrews chapter number 4 and verse number 1, you will see the promise of rest. Rest is a promise that God himself has already promised for every believer to enter. The Bible says, let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest. So rest is God's promise. It's a promise that God himself has been able to settle for the behalf of his own people. Look at Joshua chapter number 21 and verses number 44. Joshua 21 and verse 44. And the Lord gave them rest round about, according to all that he swore unto their fathers, and there stood not a man of all their enemies before them, and the Lord delivered all their enemies into their hands. So look at that. There is a promise. If you notice, the Bible says what God had sworn, what God had promised. So in Joshua 21 and verse number 44, he says, and the Lord gave them rest round about according to all that he promised, or all that he swore unto their fathers. So rest is a promise from God. Number two, rest is a will of God. Not only is it a promise, but it is God's will and God's intention. So again, in Hebrews chapter number 4 and verse number 3, the scripture says, for we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. So not only is it a promise, it is also God's will. The will of God is that we should enter rest. And the rest we are talking about here is a rest all across. Rest in terms of your spiritual rest, financial rest, physical rest, rest in terms of your health, rest in terms of your family, rest in every dimension of your life. So rest number one is God's promise. Rest number two is the will of God. God wants you to enjoy rest. Matthew 11 and verses number 28 again. Matthew 11 and verse number 28. Come ye who are labor and who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So rest is the will of God. Number three, rest is God's environment. Rest is the environment of God. So rest is not just a promise of God. Rest is not just a will of God. Rest is also the what we consider as the environment of God. So look at the verses number 9 and verses number 10 of Hebrews chapter number 4. Now today I'm just making an introduction. We are going to be building this up as we continue throughout this entire week. And we will believe God that God is going to fulfill his word, because I trust that we are in a season of rest. And I will explain why as we continue. In Hebrews chapter number 4 and verse number 9, the Bible says, there remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. So there remaineth thereof a rest for the people of God. Now that is God's promise and God's will combined. In verses number 10, the Bible says, for he that is entered into his rest has also ceased from his own works, as God did from his. So rest is God's environment. Any person that has entered rest has automatically entered into the environment of God, where God brings you into a place where you have ceased from doing things in your own effort, and the things that you used to labor for begin to fall into place by itself. Now look at the book of Psalms, chapter number 71 and verses number 20. Psalm 71 and verse 20. Rest is God's environment. And I want you to look at Psalm 71 and verse 20 and get to understand that in the environment of God, things cease. The things that you used to push, you no longer push them, because you have entered into a place where God himself now in his presence begins to allow those things to begin to fall into place. Now this is David after he has actually raised a prayer. If you read Psalm 71 and verse number 1, the first prayer that David prays is a very interesting prayer. David says, "In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be put to confusion." Look at that prayer. He's asking God, "God, please, let me never be put to confusion." Because one of the things that happens when you're under process, the tendency or the likelihood to fall into confusion is very high. Most of times, people who are under a lot of processes will end up making a lot of decisions that are out of order. That's why David says here, "Lord, let me never be put to confusion." You know, there's a scripture that I like quoting, and I tell people that's one of the reasons we have to pray for ourselves to come out of affliction. And we have to pray that if our season of process has come to an end, that the Lord will bring us out in time. That scripture is in the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 7. And if you read verses number 7 of Ecclesiastes 7, it says that oppression makes a wise man mad. Oppression makes a wise man mad. If you stay too long in affliction and too long in process and your time is already past, you know, if you stay too long in it, you will end up becoming mad. You will end up making bad decisions in your life. So when David is saying here, "Deliver me from confusion," David understands the power behind affliction, the power behind pain. Sometimes if you undergo process for too long and you do not come out of it when the time of coming out of it has already come, you will end up making a lot of confused decisions. For example, single ladies that have been praying to get married and it seems as though there is no husband or no potential man coming your way, the probability of you easily falling for any man is very high. Or even single men, or people that are believing God for job opportunities and you're believing God for God to answer you in certain ways. People tend to go for shortcuts when they feel like God has actually delayed. They give a story of a pastor who had actually been trusting God for his ministry to grow, and apparently he had one of his friends who they were praying together with. In a very short span of time, his friend happened to explode. In less than 5 months, his church was over 1,000. The guy had over 3 big vehicles. I mean, the finances were flowing extremely well. He had properties and the guy was doing very well. So this other friend of his went to him and told him, "What is it that you're doing that I'm not doing? And how comes you've been able to break forth like this, and yet we've been together? And by the way, I seem to have been slightly ahead of you." And that is when the friend of his told him, "Don't try and be like me. Just do what you're doing because you're in the right path." And he kept on telling him, "No, you have to tell me your secret." And he pestered him over a period of time. So the friend of his told him, "If you're really serious, then where I will take you to, you have to follow everything that you will be taught." And so this other friend of his took him to a certain place where he noticed that where they had gone, there were several other pastors also with big vehicles that had arrived there. And at the center of all these people, all of them sitting on the ground, was a particular occultic man. And so he looked at his friend and he told him, "Is this your secret?" He told him, "Yeah. And I told you, if you're really serious about it, I told you to keep quiet and you follow through." He said, "Anyway, if this is what gave you what you got, I want to also get it." And this is a true story that was told, and it happened in Nigeria. So this occultic guy happened to turn to him. He looked at him and he told him, "When I see you, young man, I see you're a very strong minister. What are you doing here?" He said, "I'm here because my friend brought me here, and I saw everything he had gotten in the span he had. And I told my friend that wherever he got it from, I want to also get the same thing. So I'm here to receive whatever he got." And this occultic guy looked at him and he told him that, "Listen, when I look at you, you're already doing everything correct. Why should you be here? I mean, why should you come and follow through, and yet you're doing everything correct?" Can you imagine an occultic man in the spirit can be able to decode that this other fellow is doing things correctly? The young man said, "I don't care. I want to get what you're giving him." And according to the story, the young man was told it's very easy. They took him to a room where he actually had a particular lady, and he was told, "Simply sleep with her. You'll be initiated. And after that, you will notice that you will begin to get what your friend is getting." He said, "That is simple. I will sleep with the person." Now, the guy was married. The pastor was married. And the pastor told himself, "I will sleep with the lady. Then in the morning, I will wake up, repent. And if things begin to happen, one day I will probably share with my wife." And so what happened, he slept with the lady. In the morning he woke up only to find a big python by the bedside, and he was shocked. He ran away from it. Then he got to discover blood was oozing out from his ears, from his mouth, from his nostrils, and also from his anus. And when he noticed all this, he called for his friend because he noticed the blood was really flowing out. The friend came in together with the cultic man, and they told him, that's part of the ritual. It has to happen like that. And this lady that you're sleeping with is actually a python. So that's why you're seeing that python here. So relax. Part of the blood oozing out is part of the initiation. The guy said to the friend, no, this is enough. Take me to my wife. And he drove him to the wife, and they tried to clean him up. He confessed to the wife, and he was warned that if he ever opened up to anyone, including any family member, he would die instantly. Shared with the wife, and he died right there. Now, thank God he repented. But you see, pressure in life can move you to actions that are very confusing. So that's why David says here in Psalm 71, that's why, remember, I've started with 1 Peter, and I've explained that there are three things 1 Peter chapter 10, 5 and verse 10 explains: process, grace, and settlement. And the focus here is settlement, but process is one of the things that takes you to settlement. After you have suffered a while, the God of all grace perfect you, establish you, strengthen you, and settle you, which means bring you to rest. So we want to observe here the prayer that David is praying, because now we have established here that rest, which is settlement, rest is God's promise, rest is God's will, and also rest is God's environment. We have established that. Now, but there's something that I want you to look at that will be able to help you, because now we're in Psalms 71 and verses number 1, first of all, but our focus will be verses number 19 and verse 20, verse 20 and verse number 21. So look at what David says in verse number 1. He says, in thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be put to confusion. When you are in process, pray this prayer. Ask the Lord to deliver you from any element of confusion. Look at verses number 16. Look at what he says. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only. O God, thou hast taught me from my youth, and hitherto have I declared thy wondrous works. Look at verse number 18. Now also, when I am old and gray-headed, O God, forsake me not until I have shown thy strength unto this generation, and thy power to everyone that is to come. So observe what David is actually praying. He's saying, Lord, I need you to keep on strengthening me, that even as I've committed myself to walk with you, I need strength. But I want you to observe verse 20 and verse 21. That's why we said rest is the will of God, rest is a promise of God, but rest is also the environment of God. He says, thou hast shown me great and sore troubles. Thou which has shown me great and sore troubles shall quicken me again, and shall bring me up again from the depths of the earth. Verse number 21, thou shalt increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. What he's simply trying to say is that God, you will bring me to a season of settlement. Now go again with me to Psalms chapter number 66. Observe this. It will also be a blessing to you. Psalm 66 and verse number 10 to verse number 12. Now again, rest is the will of God. Rest is a promise of God. And rest is the environment of God. Psalm 66 verse 10 to verse number 12. He says, for thou, O God, hast proved us. Thou hast tried us as silver is tried. Thou hast brought us into the net. Thou laidest affliction upon our loins. Loins is a reproductive area, the places of your produce. But listen to verse number 12. Thou hast caused men to ride over our heads. I don't know whether you've had people disturbing you, people fighting you. You are in the right moment right now. As you're listening to me, you have tuned in at the right time. He says, you have allowed men to ride over our backs. We went through fire and we went through water. But listen to what he says. But thou broughtest us out into a wealthy place. So I will go through that scripture again from verse number 10, Psalm 66. Verse 10 says, but thou, O God, hast proved us, and thou hast tried us as silver is tried. Thou brought us into a net and laid affliction upon our loins. Thou hast caused men to ride over our heads. We went through fire and we went through water, but you have brought us into a wealthy place. One translation says, you have brought us into a broad place. Another translation says, you have brought us into a moist place. Now the idea is this: for every process that God will ever take you through, God will bring you into a place of rest, a place of fulfillment, an environment he has accorded for your destiny to find expression. And now that's why we are dealing with rest. Now let's begin today by defining rest, and then we are going to just stop here. We won't really go far. We still have other days to deal with this topic. But I want just to say this to all of you that are tuning in, that prophetically in my spirit I had a very strong sensation. January, the month of February, the month of March, and the month of April have been months where God has been positioning and repositioning his church and even his own people. The month of May, beginning now, is a month where God is now settling his people for the sake of taking them to the next level. Now, let me say this. I'm going a bit ahead of myself, but I ought to make this statement. That anytime you observe the scripture, you will notice that people were only able to build when they entered a season of rest. That's one of the reasons why rest is very necessary. You can't rest when you have war all around. You can't rest when you're constantly fighting around you. You can't build when you're having wars all around you. You can't be able to progress if you're having wars all around you. But anytime you enter into a place of rest, what exactly happens is that now what is committed to you is the grace to go ahead and to build. Many people have a lot of fighting over their health, fighting over the issues of their finances, fighting over family affairs. Every time there are a lot of battles around you, the ability to enter the place of resting, to build, is denied you. That's one reason why when God is speaking, like last week he talked about restoration, and now God is telling us, he's bringing us into a season of rest in the month of May. When God brings you into rest, what God is simply announcing to you is that I'm bringing you into a season that now you can be able to build the things I had put in your heart. So check this out. What is rest? The Greek word for rest is the word anapao. The Greek word for rest is the word anapao. A-N-A-P-A-U-O. A-N-A-P-A-U-O. That is the Greek word for rest. Now this word means some few words. Number one, it means to cause to cease from any movement or labor. To cause to cease from any movement or labor in order to recover and to collect back your strength. All right? To cease from any movement or labor in order to recover or to collect the strength that you had actually utilized earlier on. So when people enter rest, they cease from working. Something stops. The things they used to push, they stop working again and stop pushing. And all of a sudden, they begin to recollect their energy and begin to rebuild themselves because of the things that they ought to be doing in the phase they are entering. Number two, that word rest in the Greek means to refresh. So when people have entered a season of rest, they are actually in a moment of refreshing, a time when they are rebuilding themselves, refreshing themselves. And number three, it means to keep quiet, to keep calm, and to be patient in expectation. To keep quiet, to keep calm, and to be patient in expectation. Now, let me say this to all of you, that whenever we enter rest, this is God's will. God wants you to enter into a season where you can now be able to refresh and to recover the energy that you had actually lost, and so that now you can be able to enter a season of building. I want you to notice that when David wanted to build, as I close today, because today I'm only making an introduction, when David wanted to build, one of the things that you will actually get to notice is that God himself stopped him and God told him, because there's blood in your hands. The blood God was talking about is not the fact that David had gone into war, but it was actually the blood of Uriah. But I want you to understand that God went beyond that. God told him, but I will give you a son, and the son that I will give you will be a son of rest. Now, this son of rest that I will give to you will be the one to build my temple. Now, I want you to notice that during the time of David, there was war. His work was to battle. And the time he was actually battling, he was battling so that God would now bring him into a season of rest in his old age, so that his son, who was now known as the son of rest, Solomon, would now come into play and begin to build the temple that God had intended for him to build, and to build the nation of Israel as the will of God was intended. This now is found in the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter number 22. And verses number 9. I want to read it for you. 1 Chronicles 22 and verse number 9. When David is actually receiving a prophetic word from God. Behold, a son shall be born to thee, who shall be a man of rest. And I will give him rest from all his enemies round about. For his name shall be called Solomon. And I will give him peace and quietness unto Israel. I will give peace and quietness unto Israel in his days. Now, God himself is actually giving a promise that in the days that this man will be there, I will ensure that, number one, he will be known as a son of rest. Number two, I will give him rest all across, even from all his enemies. And I will do so that in Israel, there will be rest. Look at verse number 10. And he shall build a house for my name, and he shall be my son, and I will be his father, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom over Israel forever. I will give you a son, and he will be a son of rest. Now, this is the word of the Lord for us today, as I come to a close for today, because today I wanted to finish early, and I just wanted to declare we have entered a season of rest. Rest is critical. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 10, and I repeat again, which is a foundational scripture, that the God of all grace, after you have suffered a while, strengthen you, establish you, perfect you, and settle you. And the word settle there means bring you to the place of rest. God is speaking that in the month of May, God is bringing us into a season of rest because God expects of us to be able to build. But I close by showing you something here that he says he shall be a man of rest. Not only will God give him rest all across, the man himself will be a man of rest. God wants you to have rest in two areas, rest internally and rest externally, so that everything you're supposed to build beginning the month of May, the grace of God will be available for you to be able to build it. Well, I'm so glad that I've been able to declare what God has allowed me to declare for today. I want you to stay with me throughout, starting tomorrow and the days after, because we will be looking at this topic and we will focus on this word called rest. And trust God that God is going to establish it in our lives, because this month is a month of rest that we can be able to enjoy everything God has intended. I love you all. I trust that you have been blessed as we made an introduction for today. And I pray that this word will become your reality and will also become a factor that you will find yourself established in to the glory of God. My name is Reverend Pancras, and this is Therapy Your Program. It's a blessing to have you as we began it. I want you to join me again tomorrow at exactly 10 minutes past 12 as we continue on entering rest, or rest all round about. It's a blessing to have had you. Please, again, if in case you need any prayer, you need any counseling, the numbers are available there and you can be able to participate. If you need also the devotional, the numbers are available there. You can communicate with me. Communicate with me by sending me your names and your interest of receiving the devotional on WhatsApp. And immediately after, I will bring you on broadcast and make you be able to receive the daily devotional every day, daily kingdom devotional, so that it can be a blessing to you. Welcome to your season of rest. Welcome to your time where God will cause you to cease from all labor in Jesus' precious name. God bless you. Have an awesome time in Jesus' name.